नमस्ते एवरीवन, दिस इज विक्रम सिंह, ग्रैंडसन ऑफ लेट नागेंद्रनाथ सिंह, गॉट दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू कंडक्ट दिस ऑनलाइन सेमिनार एंड दिस इज द 8th नागेंद्रनाथ सिंह ऑनलाइन सेमिनार मेमोरियल लेक्चर. एवरी ईयर मेनी डिग्नेटरीज जॉइन अस टू गिव देयर ओपिनियन एंड पर्सपेक्टिव ओवर द टॉपिक व्हिच आर रिलेटेड टू नेशनल एंड इंटरनेशनल इंपॉर्टेंस. बट ड्यू टू द वेग ऑफ कोरोना वायरस वी हैव शिफ्टेड दिस लेक्चर टू द ऑनलाइन प्लेटफॉर्म. I would want to introduce to our guest speakers for this event, Mr. Manish Tiwari sir, our chief guest for the day. He is the member of parliament from Anandpur Sahib, Punjab. He was also elected as member of parliament from Ludhiana constituency in 2009. He was also the president of National Student Union of India and Youth Congress. He also served as Union Minister Information and Broadcasting from 2009 to 2014. He is the voice of India masses and a senior leader in Congress and a dignified lawyer by profession. Our next speaker is Mr. Neeraj Kumar, who worked in insurance industry for 35 years, has been the part of LIC Housing Finance, Indian Housing Markets and private life insurance companies. And now he is the consultant and advising many different companies on business development. His expertise and experience will give us the good insight on the topic which we will have an elaborated discussion on. Thank you so much for joining us, sir. Our chairperson for this lecture, Mr. Rajit Kumar Jha. He is the editor research of Outlook magazine, has been the editor research of India Today magazine, a chief editor of Tribune Media Company in Doha, Qatar and Muscat. He has been the resident editor of Times of India and Indian Express newspaper. I just want to thank our guests for accepting our invitation for this event. And we all know that this online seminar has been organized in the memory of late Nagendranath Singh. So I would like to give you a brief about his life journey. Late Nagendranath Singh, my grandfather was born on 9th August 1925 in Baranagar village, which is situated near the banks of river Sariu. In his childhood, he went to a school where spinning of charkha and wearing khadi was mandatory. And this led a very patriotic feeling in him from his very early childhood. And this school was actually quite famous all over the India. And it was itself run by a freedom fighter. In secondary school, he received Edward Scholarship for academics by British government. He participated in Quit India movement in 1942 on the call of Mahatma Gandhi at the age of 17 and was honored as a recipient of Swatantrata Sangram Senani Samman by Government of India. He was elected as a member of executive body of Student Congress and Youth Congress, and which was led by Indira Gandhi. In 1957, he contested parliamentary elections from the Praja Socialist Party. He always believed that the welfare of the people can be done by the active participation in politics. In 1976, he was elected the member of Legislative Council from Gorakhpur during the time of emergency. And again in 1982, he elected as a member of Legislative Council from the Assembly constituency. He was also the chief editor of Hindi newspaper, Dainik. In 1997, he participated in International Hindi Conference held in London on the invitation of Hindi Samiti, United Kingdom. He was elected as a president of Motilal Memorial Society in 2005 and again in 2008. Motilal Memorial Society was founded by our late Chief Minister, Mr. C.B. Gupta. And this society runs various charitable institutions which are actually related to the health, education and welfare of underprivileged people. My grandfather passed away on 25th of August 2012, leaving behind his work and inspiration for many others. He always used to say to me that your deeds are very important and your deeds should be done for a greater good, because when you leave this place, your deeds are the only thing which are left behind, and it should be in the contribution to the society. And we will try our best to take the legacy forward. Now coming on the topic of this event, we all know that the world is going through an unprecedented event, which is coronavirus. all the countries of the world are in the race of developing the vaccine. And India, we have seen the drawback of socio-economic front and lowering of GDP. We have seen the migration of laborers to their villages. And according to the report, around 2 crore people have lost their jobs. But we as a nation are fighting hard. On the sideline of this, we have seen Chinese aggression. Chinese aggression in different parts of the world. We have seen Chinese aggression in the South China Sea. We have seen Chinese aggression in the Hong Kong regarding the national security laws. We have seen Chinese aggression in the Galwan Valley, in the line of actual control, where we lost over 20 brave Indian soldiers. And we have seen Chinese interference in the Chabahar port, putting off the railway project of India in Iran. And we all are aware of the fact that there is a trade war going on between United States of America and Republic of China. So I would like to request our chairperson for this event, Mr. Ajit Kumar Jha, sir, to give us an insight over this and put the things into perspective. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Vikram. Thank you very much. Can I ask a couple of questions? Is Mr. Manish Tiwari already available or not yet?
I hope he will be joining us soon, sir. We will.
The other problem the technical people should handle is that the voice is not very clear to me. Neeraj, can you hear me clearly, Neeraj? Neeraj, can you hear me?
There is a lot of disturbance.
I also find a lot of disturbance. When Vikram spoke, I could not. I find the voice crackling. So Manish has also come. Welcome, Manish.
Thank you.
Welcome, Manish.
Okay.
So without, if the technical persons can improve the voice, please do so. But without much further delay, let me begin. Let me point out what an honor it is to speak on, you know, this occasion in memory of Nagendranath ji. In fact, I must thank the person who's not visible, Rajesh Singh, who's a dear friend and he was senior to me in college. We met about 3 years ago in Gorakhpur when I was invited to come and speak there in this forum. And today we are back again on this forum in a webinar. So let me point out what a privilege it is to come and speak in front of such an august gathering. And we have sort of wonderful speakers. Manish Tiwari, all of you know. Welcome, Mr. Tiwari. He is a member of parliament of the Congress Party, a renowned lawyer, an excellent speaker in both English and Hindi. If this seminar was going on television, I would have focused on another area. But at this moment, let me stick to the subject that we are handling. The second speaker of the day, Neeraj Kumar, an extraordinary economist who has been with the insurance sector for a very long time. He's a very good market analyst. I have known Neeraj for a very, very long time, since my JNU days. So let's begin with the subject. What we unfortunately face today is an extraordinary sort of circumstance, a sort of crisis which began with COVID pandemic, and almost by March 24th, the lockdown began. We were being hit by early March in Rajasthan and other states, in Kerala, for example. And today the situation is, I would argue, quite bad. You know, across the world, we have something like 24 million cases, 2.4 crores in about 8 countries. The situation is very bad. And these 8 countries almost constitute, two-thirds, 66.6% of the total cases in the world, which is almost 24 million cases, as I pointed out. In India alone, we have about 3.1 million cases, almost 31 lakhs as of today. Back in June, 24th of June, the recorded figure was nearly 0.4 million. So from 4 lakhs to 31 lakhs in a period of what I would argue 6 weeks. Now, what are we faced with? I mean, what are some of the long-term implications that we should talk about? Because much of the figure is out in the open in the media. You know, every day people are listening to television. There are several other sources, the government source, the media, independent hospital sources coming up. All of us are clued in into what we call the Johns Hopkins Center. So what are we actually faced with? Let me, because I'm simply making as a chair opening remarks, I would leave this the detailed discussion to our speakers, Mr. Tiwari and Mr. Neeraj Kumar. But let me make some very general comments. Let me pick up something which has not been much discussed in the media. If you compare today's COVID crisis to the Spanish flu, which was, you know, 1918, so one of the things that happened, if you look at the census figures in India, fortunately, we have census figures from almost 1870s. If you look at the census figures, it shows that only once in India's history, you had a population decline. So, and that was the year 1918, basically. So what I'm trying to point out that for the first time in Indian history, we might be faced with demographically something called a population decline. Now, is that a good thing or bad thing? We don't know. Because it has wider ramifications. You see, what tends to happen during a crisis like this is that the number of births that take place kind of shoots down. Why? Because women between the ages of, let's say, 18, which is the marriageable age, to about 45, their fertility suffers. And that can have long-term implications in terms of aging of the population, in terms of the gender ratio, the male-female gender ratio. So at this moment, we are not very clear what the long-term implications will be, but it is going to have a sort of severe demographic changes might take place. Now, that is something that the media hasn't discussed very seriously. Let me just point out one more issue. I'll just flag it. And that is, compared to the 2007 economic crisis, the recession that started in the US and kind of spread all over, one thing that we have noticed again compared to that crisis is that more men lost jobs in 2007. Some of the initial figures that came out in India and abroad, Europe, America, it shows that women have been affected much more than only males in this crisis, in the 2020 COVID crisis. So now there have been reports about massive increase in domestic violence, for example, France, even in China, several other countries, and in India. The National Commission of Women gave out figures which showed great increase in sort of domestic violence, number one. Number two, women faced a crisis there was a negative double whammy. Why? Because they are forced into homes, they work, they are doing work from home, and at the same time, there are no places to take care of children, right? So they have to take care of the children as well. So now this is one aspect of the problem, which as I am pointing out, has not been much discussed in the media. There have been some reports, but I think a very serious issue. Now let me kind of shift, because I want to leave the debate to Mr. Tiwari and Neeraj. Let me shift to basically what is it that, where is it leading to in terms of an economic crisis, an issue that you will have Mr. Tiwari talk about, you will have Neeraj discuss in details. Let me just point out again, I hear a crackling sound actually. I don't know if others are also hearing that. The technical team, can you just cut down the crackling sound, please? Anyway, I'll continue. Let's look at the broad figures, the big numbers. There is a massive decline in GDP. Now, there are various estimates. Some people estimate that the GDP decline in India will be as high as 15%. The IMF projects a contraction of almost 4.5%. The World Bank's earlier estimate was about 3.2%, but the World Bank has said that they will revise the figures in October. However, even the RBI points out that there will be a contraction of the economy, and the fact that the RBI has released over $50 billion, we are talking about in rupee terms, almost 1.3 trillion rupees into the economy, shows that the RBI is aware of how serious this economic crisis is. Now, sorry, I made a mistake. It's almost 2.8 trillion that the RBI has released. So, of course, our Prime Minister Modi is the eternal optimist. He points out that there are green shoots of recovery in certain sectors. We have heard the Niti Aayog pointed out about some green shoots in agriculture. However, I think these are very early figures and we cannot take it very seriously. I myself wrote on agriculture several articles, and I found that, you know, for example, if you just look at Rabi crop, there was total slaughter in the perishable sectors, vegetables, fruits, in the early period of the Rabi period, especially in the so-called southern states, even including Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, which goes for early Rabi harvest. It was a serious case. In fact, despite all efforts, a major effort was made to save the wheat crop in the northern states, in Punjab, Haryana, UP. So to some extent that they were able to, but I still think agriculture also faces a very serious crisis. And of course, every other sector, as we know, other than agriculture and health, was basically locked down for a long period, especially, you know, medium and, you know, the small industry, they have suffered a great deal. The informal sector has almost been destroyed in the country. So, you know, it's all in all, we are facing a very, very serious crisis. In fact, before the crisis began, the Modi government had made a target, which was that by 2024, India will be a $5 trillion economy. And already the official sources are pointing out, in fact, they have released the data, I think, yesterday, that there'll be major revisions in this attempt, in this goal of 5 trillion. In fact, privately, some government sources points out that we may not even reach 5 trillion by 2030. Now, right now, India is a $2.8 trillion economy. Now, what does it mean? I mean, in comparative terms, if we are arguing that India is a $2.8 trillion economy, just compare it to China, which we will, because all the speakers will, because we are talking about a Chinese aggression, you know, as recent as May 24th. So what are we talking about? China is about, according to some estimates, about $15 trillion economy already. And we are sort of struggling at $2.8 trillion. Now, remember, both these countries are comparable, in almost comparable in terms of population and otherwise. We are large sort of Asian powers. And also remember that if we simply look at trade between India and China, if you add up both China and Hong Kong, then this was the largest trading partner India had. I mean, Hong Kong, China was number one. Number two was UAE. Hong Kong, China alone was over $100 billion trade. I mean, Neeraj and Mr. Tiwari will sort of maybe give out more actual numbers, but we were almost over $100 billion with China. Number two was UAE, and number three was the US. So now this kind of large trade has been affected a great deal because of the Chinese aggression that took place. And we are actually in a fairly, I won't go into the details of the Chinese aggression because all of you are familiar with it. What happened in the Galwan Valley, the fact that we lost about 20 Indian soldiers. On the Chinese side, we've heard about 43 Chinese soldiers. We also lost a sort of senior military officer, which was very unfortunate. In fact, most of the soldiers we lost was from Bihar Regiment, a state which I come from. Fortunately, there have been some reports of disengagement in Galwan Valley and Hot Springs around 24th of July. But I think we have troops on both sides which are masked, and we are still sort of unsure of the diplomatic sort of a relationship that's going on. But what I feel is that, I'm talking about very long term. I mean, China and India share one of the largest borders in the world. And we have been neighbors for thousands of years, and we have to live with each other in the future. So I feel that, the Chinese aggression, the Chinese nationalism, which has taken a recent muscular character in response to its trade war going on with the US, needs to be curbed. But I do feel that we need to sort this problem out for a long-term sort of prosperity in this region. We need to live with our neighbors, with peace and we need to improve the relationship rather than let it sort of flounder and become worse. I mean, after all, in 1962, we had a war, which it took a long time. I mean, when Rajiv Gandhi became the prime minister, for the first time, we started improving bilateral border trade. Then Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee sort of helped in improving that further. And we had reached, as I pointed out, almost $100 billion trade between the two countries. In fact, the entire Beijing Olympics was carried out on iron ore supplied from Goa, which led to the modernization of Goa. So we must remember that once trade flows, sort of diplomatic relations become better. Armies sort of, military relations sort of improve. So I think it's important to remember this, that in our attempt to bring about a recovery, we must try and improve this relation with China. Of course, as I pointed out, the Chinese needs to be more sort of responsible power. It wants to be a superpower, but of late it has shown serious signs of aggression, not only in the Indo-China border, but also in the South China Sea, its relations with Japan, its relations with Australia, with Southeast Asian countries have actually declined recently. Now, the last thing, because I see I've almost spoken for half an hour, the last thing I wanted to sort of just flag off some of the issues which the speakers will be able to talk about is is it time to start talking of recovery, number one? What kind of recovery are we thinking of? Is it going to be sort of what economists call at times a V-shaped or U-shaped recovery, a quick recovery? Or is it going to be a long-term recovery? Sometimes they call it W-shaped and all kinds of other shapes. So that is something we need to know. Secondly, much more important, what should the Indian government focus on? Should the focus be on infrastructure sector? As some people compare this crisis with, you know, the New Deal that came after the Second World War, where the Roosevelt government spent you know, trillions trying to change American economy, restructure American economy, and America started emerging as a superpower, and therefore create jobs? Or should the focus be on sectors like health? You know, health is something really neglected in India. There's a massive shortage of doctors, of nurses, of medical infrastructure in this country, and especially in eastern states, in the Bimaru states. So should the focus be on health or education? I mean, education is, most of you are aware, is already sort of affected a great deal during this COVID crisis. All the kids are, most of the kids are actually just on doing online classes. Should we have a serious attempt to restructure Indian education? I mean, the government has passed the new education policy. But I think we need to think much more seriously about how we are going to do this, rather than simply numbers. Should undergraduate be 3 years or 4 years, or should there be just some flexibility, or do we really need to reskill our working forces, our youngsters? That is something that in the recovery we need to focus on. Should we focus, to some extent, the Modi government has recently focused on water and sanitation, a very serious issue for health. So should we sort of try and do that? Or as I feel, should the big focus be on modernization of Indian agriculture? Because after all, at this point of crisis, the only thing that seems to be kind of the only hope in the economy seems to be agriculture, which I must admit has been greatly neglected over the years, both during, I would argue, the UPA regime and during the NDA regime. So agricultural growth rate is something which we nearly need to take care of. And finally, the question of jobs. I mean, remember, as the New York Times pointed out, America itself has lost over 60 million jobs have been lost in the U.S., the largest economy in the world, which is almost a $21 trillion economy. In India, we don't have very good figures. We don't have weekly data, job losses and others. But still, the ILO estimate that I saw, I mean, Neeraj and Mr. Tiwari can correct me, something over 4.5 lakh jobs we have lost. So has the MGNREGA program helped to recover any of that? We have a very large informal sector in which we don't have very good figures on job losses, but we saw, all of us saw on television, the kind of migration that was going on. You know, people walking thousands of miles from Punjab and Delhi to Bihar, to Jharkhand, to Chhattisgarh, to UP. It was really chilling, the entire sort of picture. So where do we need to focus? And finally, is there hope at all today? I mean, I just saw an interview 2 days ago of Bill Gates I think it was on the BBC. And the one question they asked him, does he think things are already going to improve or get worse? And someone like Gates, who I think is very knowledgeable about the COVID pandemic, pointed out that before the recovery, there is going to be a worse fail. So that is something we need to know. What is the deadline of the recovery? So I have raised quite a lot of questions. I'll sort of go to our speakers. Our first speaker is Mr. Tiwari. Other than, you know, all these questions that I raised, I would want to know two things from Mr. Tiwari. Mr. Tiwari, one, what do you feel has been the Modi government's record on the pandemic, on the economy, and on the Chinese aggression? Has it made it worse? Was the lockdown sort of announced very early? Did they mess it up? Or has it been a sort of a, let's say, a more better story, number one? And number two, what I would like to know is, what is the role of the opposition in that? I mean, the main principal party being Congress Party, at this moment, according to reports, it faces a crisis. How responsible has the opposition's role been in this sort of how to resolve the crisis? So let me go back to Mr. Tiwari. So over to you, Mr. Tiwari. Thank you.
आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद झा जी. आपने बड़े विस्तार से जो मुद्दे इस मुल्क के सामने हैं उनकी चर्चा की है. सबसे पहले तो मैं हमारे मित्र राजेश सिंह जी को, जिनको मैं पिछले 35 साल से जानता हूँ, 80 के दशक में हम लोगों की मुलाकात हुई थी, सबसे पहले तो मैं उनका धन्यवाद करना चाहता हूँ कि उन्होंने मुझे इस लायक समझा कि 8वां जो मेमोरियल लेक्चर है नगेंद्र नाथ सिंह जी की याद में, उसको संबोधित करने के लिए उन्होंने मुझे निमंत्रण दिया. सबसे पहले तो मैं नगेंद्र नाथ जी को अपनी ओर से श्रद्धांजलि देना चाहता हूँ. मुझे उनसे मिलने का अवसर तो नहीं प्राप्त हुआ, पर मैंने जो भी पढ़ा है उसके हिसाब से वो एक बहुत ही अच्छे समाजसेवी थे, कर्मठ राजनीतिक कार्यकर्ता थे. उनकी समाज सुधार में, शिक्षा के सुधार में जो वैचारिक का परिपेक्ष है, जो वैचारिक प्रांगण है इस देश का, उसमें बहुत बहुत पैनी दिलचस्पी थी और बड़ी संस्थाओं के साथ उनका वास्ता रहा. और पूरी अपनी जिंदगी एक राजनीतिक और सामाजिक कार्यकर्ता के रूप में उन्होंने बिताई. और मुझे आज, मैं अपने आप को सौभाग्यवादी समझता हूँ कि उनके इस मेमोरियल लेक्चर में मुझे शरीक होने का मौका मिला. अजीत कुमार झा जी ने काफी सवाल हमारे सामने रखे हैं और मैं एक एक करके उन सवालों के ऊपर अपना पक्ष रखना चाहूंगा या अपनी बात रखना चाहूंगा. सबसे पहली बात जो हमको संज्ञान में लेने की जरूरत है कि 1918 के बाद जो पहले महायुद्ध का आखिरी साल था, एक बीमारी यूरोप में शुरू हुई. उस वो बीमारी कहाँ से शुरू हुई? जो जवान लड़ रहे थे यूरोप में फ्रंट लाइन्स के ऊपर, क्या उनके अस्पतालों से शुरू हुई या कहीं और से शुरू हुई? तो एक फ्लू शुरू हुआ जिसके कारण बहुत लोग बहुत जल्दी मरने शुरू हो. और क्योंकि युद्ध का समय था, कोई मुल्क ये नहीं चाहता था कि इसका जो सच है वो पूरी तरह से उजागर हो, क्योंकि लोगों के मनोबल के ऊपर उसका असर पड़ता था, तो इसको दबा के रखने की कोशिश की गई. स्पेन एक ऐसा मुल्क था जहां पर, जो इस जंग का हिस्सा नहीं था, जहां से पत्रकार अपनी बात रिपोर्ट किया करते थे, और उन्होंने इस फ्लू की जानकारी पूरी दुनिया में पहुंचानी शुरू की, और इसके कारण उसका नाम पड़ गया स्पेनिश फ्लू. और जैसे जैसे ये बीमारी यूरोप से ब्रितानिया आई, ब्रितानिया के रास्ते ये मिडल ईस्ट में गई, अफ्रीका में गई, भारत आई, 5 लाख जानों का नुकसान हो गया। उस समय ये वायरस के बारे में इतनी जानकारी भी नहीं थी कि इस वायरस से कैसे निपटा जाए। और मुझे याद है कि मेरी नानी हमको बताया करती थी कि जब ये महामारी आई तो वो भी शायद 20 साल की रही हो, तो कैसे लोगों ने अपने आप को महीनों तक घरों में बंद कर लिया था, लोग बाहर नहीं निकलते थे। और जब मकान खुले तो कई ऐसे मकान थे जिसमें पूरे पूरे परिवार ही तबाह हो गए उस बीमारी के कारण। तो एक बहुत बड़ा प्रकोप 20वीं सदी के दूसरे दशक में लोगों को झेलना पड़ा। पर 20वीं सदी कुछ मानवीय कुछ मानवीय जानों की लिहाज से तो बहुत ही अद्भुत और विचित्र सदी थी। पहला महायुद्ध हुआ, फिर स्पेनिश फ्लू हुआ, उसके कुछ वर्ष बाद इकोनॉमिक डिप्रेशन हुआ, इकोनॉमिक डिप्रेशन के बाद दूसरा महायुद्ध हुआ। हिटलर ने कोशिश की कि जो पूरी यहूदी रेस है उसी को तबाह कर दिया जाए कॉन्सेंट्रेशन कैंप्स में बंद करके, और 60 लोगों को 5 साल में मौत के घाट उतार दिया गया। कॉन्सेंट्रेशन कैंप्स एक नया आविष्कार इस 20वीं सदी का मानवता को देखने को मिला। इसलिए जब ये महामारी जिसको COVID-19 कहते हैं, जिसको वैसे तो चाइना वायरस कहा जाना चाहिए था, क्योंकि अब चाइना को इस चीज से आपत्ति है, पर अगर आप इतिहास फरोल के देखो तो हांगकांग वायरस और बाकी कई और ऐसी बीमारियां आई जिनको जहां से उनका ऐजाद हुआ उस देश का उनको नाम दिया गया या उनको संज्ञा दी गई। तो नवंबर के महीने में चीन में कुछ लोग नमोनिया से बीमार होने शुरू हुए, और जब वो अस्पताल गए बीमारी का पता नहीं लग पाया और लोग मरने शुरू हुए। दिसंबर आते आते वुहान शहर में ये जो क्राइसिस था ये और ज़्यादा गहरा गया, और कुल मिलाकर 31 दिसंबर 2019 को, जो पिछले वर्ष का आखिरी दिन था, चीन ने वर्ल्ड हेल्थ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन को ये इतला दी कि भई ऐसा ऐसी कोई नई बीमारी आई है जिसका हमारे पास कोई इलाज नहीं है और इसके कारण हमारे यहाँ पे मौतें हो रही हैं। ये जब खबर वर्ल्ड हेल्थ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन तक पहुंची और वर्ल्ड हेल्थ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ने वो खबर बाकी मुल्कों को भेजी, तो ये स्वाभाविक था कि एक आनंद फानंद मिच गया और लोग चीन से अपनी जो फ्लाइट्स थी उन फ्लाइट्स को उन्होंने बंद करना शुरू किया। 7-8 जनवरी को वर्ल्ड हेल्थ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ने बहुत ही विचित्र ट्वीट्स किए और उन्होंने ये कहा कि चीन से जो हवाई संपर्क का की प्रक्रिया है उसको बंद करने की कोई जरूरत नहीं है। और ये उस समय हो रहा था कि एक तरफ तो चीन वुहान से और हुआबी प्रोविंस से चीन के बाकी हिस्सों में रेलगाड़ियां, बस, हवाई जहाज बंद कर रहा था, और अगर आप किसी भी अंतर्राष्ट्रीय हवाई मैप के ऊपर जाके देखिए तो जनवरी के पहले हफ्ते में वुहान और हुआबी प्रोविंस से, जो उनका प्रदेश है जिसमें इसका ज्यादा प्रकोप देखने को मिला, उससे जितनी आउटगोइंग फ्लाइट्स थी वो आउटगोइंग फ्लाइट्स की संख्या 5% 10% रह गई थी। अगर दिसंबर के महीने में वो 100 थी, जनवरी के पहले हफ्ते आते आते वो 5 या 10 हो गए। और उसी समय चीन ये इंसिस्ट करता रहा कि जो अंतर्राष्ट्रीय फ्लाइट्स हैं, इवन वुहान से जो अंतर्राष्ट्रीय फ्लाइट्स हैं, जो हवाई यातायात है, उसको खुला रखा जाना चाहिए। और ये कारण था कि ये जो बीमारी चीन में उत्पन्न हुई, और कैसे उत्पन्न हुई मैं उसके ऊपर दोबारा आता हूँ, इसके बाद आता हूँ, ये बीमारी बाकी दुनिया में फैलनी शुरू हुई। और इटली में सबसे ज़्यादा जनवरी और फरवरी के महीने में मौत होने का कारण भी ये है क्योंकि वुहान और मिलान शहर के बीच जो हाई फैशन लेदर इंडस्ट्री है, उस हाई फैशन लेदर इंडस्ट्री का एक बहुत ही नज़दीक का ताल्लुक है। और इसीलिए चाहे मिलान हो चाहे न्यूयॉर्क हो, इन शहरों को इसका ज़्यादा प्रकोप झेलना पड़ा। जहाँ तक रही बात की ये COVID-19 कहाँ से आया, ये कोरोना वायरस कहाँ से आया, चीन इसकी जांच नहीं होने दे रहा, क्योंकि बहुत सारे विशेषज्ञों का ये मानना है कि अगर ये बायोलॉजिकल वेपन नहीं था तो ये वुहान इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ वायरोलॉजी में ज़रूर कोई ना कोई एक्सीडेंट हुआ, जहाँ पे इन वायरसेस के ऊपर रिसर्च की जाती थी, जो पेंगुलिन वायरसेस हैं या जो चिमगादड़ों में पाई जाती हैं, और कहीं पे वहाँ पे लैब में या तो एक्सीडेंट हुआ या कोई व्यक्ति इन्फेक्ट हो गया और उससे ये वायरस वुहान के फूड मार्केट में गया, जो वेट मार्केट जिसको कहते हैं, जहाँ जंगली जानवरों को काट के बेचा जाता है। क्योंकि चीन और भारत में फ़र्क ये है कि हमारे जो शाकाहारी हैं वो बहुत ही कम ऐसी चीज़ें हैं जो मीट से संबंधित है, बहुत कम चीज़ों को खाते हैं। पर जहाँ तक चीन का संबंध है, चीन में इसका विस्तार बहुत ज़्यादा है और चीन में जो लोग हैं वो काफ़ी ऐसी स्पीसीज को भी खाते हैं जिनको बाकी लोग जिनसे परहेज करते हैं। तो बहरहाल इसका नतीजा ये हुआ कि अप्रैल मार्च आते आते अगर 800 करोड़ इस लोग इस दुनिया में रहते हैं तो 500 करोड़ लोग किसी ना किसी लॉकडाउन में उनको जाना पड़ा। और चीन की तरफ से बिल्कुल ये कोशिश की गई कि इसके ऊपर पर्दा डाला जाए, और उसमें बहुत उनकी सहायता वर्ल्ड हेल्थ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ने भी की। जहां तक भारत का सवाल है, भारत में पहला केस केरल में पाया गया 30 जनवरी 2020 को, और 30 जनवरी 2020 से लेकर 23 मार्च 2020 तक 53 दिन होते हैं, 54 दिन होते हैं, उन 53-54 दिनों में सरकार की तरफ से हर ऐसी कोशिश हुई कि इसको प्ले डाउन किया जाए। मुझे याद है कि जो लोग इस दौरान लोकसभा और राज्यसभा में मास्क डाल के भी गए, तो राज्यसभा के उपसभापति श्री वेंकैया नायडू जी का वीडियो मौजूद है, उन्होंने बहुत डांट के फटकार के उनको कहा कि ये मास्क बाहर उतार के आइए। तो सरकार की तरफ से जो संजीदगी होनी चाहिए, क्योंकि फरवरी तक ये बात बिल्कुल बिल्कुल स्पष्ट हो गई थी कि यूरोप में ये जो बीमारी है वो बहुत भयंकर तरीके से फैलनी शुरू हुई थी और उसके कारण बहुत सारे लोगों की मौत भी होनी शुरू हो गई थी। तो इसलिए ये जो संजीदगी या जो तैयारी भारत सरकार को करनी चाहिए थी 30 जनवरी 2020 और 23 मार्च 2020 के बीच, वो तैयारी कहीं पे भी दिखने को नहीं मिली। 23 मार्च 2020 को आनन फानन में प्रधानमंत्री जी ने पहले जनता कर्फ्यू का ऐलान किया और उसके एक दिन बाद लॉकडाउन का ऐलान कर दिया। अगर आप पूरी दुनिया को अपने संज्ञान में लें तो जिस तरह का लॉकडाउन भारत में हुआ था 23 मार्च से लेकर 15 मई तक, शायद ऐसा लॉकडाउन दुनिया के किसी मुल्क में भी ना हुआ। चीन ने भी वुहान में और वुहान के आसपास के जो 5 शहर थे उसमें लॉकडाउन किया, पूरे चीन में लॉकडाउन नहीं किया। और उस 73 दिन के लॉकडाउन के बाद जो ग्राफ था वो ग्राफ फ्लैटन होना शुरू हो गया। पर भारत एक ऐसा मुल्क है जहां पर ये ग्राफ चढ़ता ही जा रहा है, ना ही इसकी कोई पीक आ रही है और ना ही ये फ्लैटन हो रहा है। जिस दिन लॉकडाउन किया गया था उस दिन भारत में 381 केस थे और 7 मौतें हुई थी, और ये केस 115 जिलों से आए थे। और आज 5 महीने के बाद भारत में 30 लाख केस हैं, जबकि भारत में टेस्टिंग सारी दुनिया की बनस्पत सबसे कम है। तो इसका कितना प्रकोप है बीमारी का, कितने लोगों को इसने के ऊपर असर हुआ है, साइंसदानों का मानना है कि हो सकता है 15 करोड़, 20 करोड़, 30 करोड़ लोगों को भारत में ये बीमारी हो चुकी हो, उनको पता भी ना लगा हो। और इस बीमारी को के खत्म होने का अभी कोई मौका नहीं दिख रहा है। There seems to be no light at the end of the tunnel। और इसीलिए मैं कई बार कह चुका हूं that the tragedy of the last 5 months is that economists turned into epidemiologists and epidemiologists turned into economists. While the latter, former could not flatten the curve, the latter have flattened the economy. तो इस लॉकडाउन का असर अगर किसी चीज के ऊपर पड़ा तो भारत की अर्थव्यवस्था के ऊपर पड़ा, और भारत की अर्थव्यवस्था पूरी तरह से ध्वस्त हो गई। पर उस पे आने से पहले मैं एक बात जरूर आपसे कहना चाहूंगा कि COVID-19 का जो पैंडेमिक है इसने एक चीज बहुत साफ तौर पर उजागर की है, और वो ये कि जो ग्लोबल गवर्नेंस की इंस्टीट्यूशंस है वो पूरी तरह से विफल रही। दूसरे महायुद्ध के बाद जिस ढांचे का निर्माण किया गया उसमें संयुक्त राष्ट्र महासंघ शामिल हो, संयुक्त राष्ट्र महासंघ की जो सिक्योरिटी काउंसिल है वो शामिल हो, वर्ल्ड हेल्थ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन शामिल हो, जब ऐसी दुनिया के स्तर पर महामारी आई तो rather than finding a global solution we were left with sub-nationalistic or even more minimalist solutions। और उसका सलूशन हमने क्या निकाला कि भाई सब लोगों को अपने घरों में बंद कर दो। यही काम 8.5 साल पहले हुआ था जब यूरोप में ग्रेट बुबोनिक प्लेग आया था। अगर मेरी याददाश्त ठीक है तो शायद 1251 के आसपास यूरोप में जो चूहे से बीमारी होती है बुबोनिक प्लेग वो आया था, और कई महीनों तक लोगों ने उससे निपटने के लिए अपने आप को अपने घरों में बंद कर लिया था। तो साइंस की और विज्ञान की इतनी तरक्की के बाद भी हमने हथियार वही इस्तेमाल किया जो हमारे पूर्वजों ने 800 वर्ष पहले इस्तेमाल किया था, और ये बताता है कि विज्ञान और टेक्नोलॉजी जो नेचर है, जो कुदरत है, उसके सामने कितनी बौनी पड़ जाती है। और सबसे सबसे जो दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण बात यह है कि जब ये पैंडेमिक फैल रहा था तो संयुक्त राष्ट्र सुरक्षा परिषद की जो अध्यक्षता थी वो मार्च के महीने में चीन के पास थी, और फरवरी के महीने में, फरवरी 2020 में, और पूरे एक महीने तक चीन ने संयुक्त राष्ट्र सुरक्षा परिषद में कोविड-19 के ऊपर बहस ही नहीं होने दी। जब वो अध्यक्षता मार्च में डोमिनिशन रिपब्लिक के पास गई, उसके बाद उन्होंने इसके ऊपर, संयुक्त राष्ट्र महासंघ ने इसके ऊपर बातचीत की, पर ना ही संयुक्त राष्ट्र महासंघ ना ही G20 जो आर्थिक महामंदी के बाद बना था 2008 में, या और कोई संस्था इस चुनौती से निपटने के लिए प्रभावशाली रूप से अग्रसर नहीं दिखाई दे। तो सबसे पहली जरूरत तो ये है कि हमको ये जो ग्लोबल इंस्टीट्यूशंस ऑफ गवर्नेंस है इनको रीकास्ट करने की जरूरत है। The entire Bretton Woods institutions and the entire United Nations system will have to be re-examined in the light of the experience of the past 5 months or what is continuing. अब चीन के सामने बड़ी विडंबना खड़ी हो गई, चीन की बड़ी बेइज्जती होनी शुरू हो गई पूरी दुनिया में कि इन लोगों ने तो दुनिया मरवा दी, अर्थव्यवस्थाएं तबाह करा दी, लोगों को बेघर कर दिया, अमेरिका और कई मुल्कों में लॉसूट्स फाइल हो गए चीन के खिलाफ, और हर अखबार की सुर्खियां चीन को इसके लिए जवाबदार मानने लगी कि चीन इसके लिए जिम्मेवार है। तो चीन ने क्या किया? चीन ने इन सारी हेडलाइंस से लोगों की का ध्यान हटाने के लिए उन्होंने 3 अंतरराष्ट्रीय क्राइसिस क्रिएट किए। पहला अंतरराष्ट्रीय क्राइसिस कि उन्होंने साउथ चाइना सी, जिसे 9 डैश लाइन कहते हैं, साउथ चाइना सी, चीन, वियतनाम, फिलीपींस, इंडोनेशिया, मलेशिया, काफी मुल्कों की जो सरहदें हैं उस छूता है, और उसमें काफी जो जमीन है वियतनाम जिसके ऊपर अपनी प्रभुसत्ता जमाता है, या फिलीपींस जमाता है, या इंडोनेशिया जमाता है, इन सब के ऊपर चीन भी अपने आप को कहता है कि ये जो इतने टापू हैं ये हमारे हैं। तो उन्होंने पहले तो 2 नए एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव डिस्ट्रिक्ट, 2 प्रशासनिक डिस्ट्रिक्ट डिक्लेयर कर दिए आपके साउथ चाइना सी में, जिससे कि उसके ऊपर वाद विवाद शुरू हो जाए, लोग आपत्ति लें, चीन के आक्रामक होके उन आइलैंड्स के ऊपर, टापुओं के ऊपर अपना और कब्जा जमाना शुरू करे, अमेरिका की तरफ से फ्रीडम ऑफ नेविगेशन ऑपरेशंस बहुत तेजी से लॉन्च होने शुरू हो गए। दूसरा, उसने हांगकांग की प्रभुसत्ता के ऊपर हाथ डाला। हांगकांग 1839 में जब पहली ओपियम वॉर होती है, और ये बहुत अद्भुत इतिहास है कि चीन एक बहुत ही शांति प्रिय मुल्क था, और चीन अपने आप में ही रहता था, ज्यादा उसका कोई लेना देना नहीं रहता था दुनिया में। तो जो अंग्रेज साम्राज्यवादी थे ये बहुत बदमाश थे, इन्होंने सोचा कि भाई पैसा कैसे कमाया जाए, तो उन्होंने भारत में अफीम उगाते थे और उस अफीम को जाके चीन में बेचते थे, और जब चीन के बादशाहों ने इस चीज के ऊपर आपत्ति जाहिर की कि आप हमारे लोगों को नशेड़ी क्यों बना रहे हैं, तो इन्होंने 1839 में पहली ओपियम वॉर उनके ऊपर शुरू कर दी, और चीन को बहुत पीटा। उनके जो कोस्ट के शहर थे, जो टाप जो समुद्र के किनारे शहर थे, उनके ऊपर कब्जा किया, लोगों को मारा, औरतों के साथ बलात्कार किया, और 1842 आते आते जो दूसरा महायुद्ध हुआ, जो सेकेंड ओपियम वॉर होती है, उसमें उन्होंने जाके जो उनका विंटर पैलेस, समर पैलेस था, उसको नष्ट कर दिया, और फिर चीन के साथ संधि की, और उस संधि में उनको हांगकांग और कई और ऐसे टापू मिले जो 1897 से लेके 1997 तक 100 साल के लीज के ऊपर चीन ने ब्रिटानिया को हांगकांग का टापू दिया था। सो 1997 में चीन को, ब्रिटानिया को हांगकांग लौटाना पड़ा, पर जब इसको लौटाया गया तो चीन ने ये वायदा किया था कि हम वन नेशन टू सिस्टम्स मेंटेन करेंगे, कि हांगकांग में जो लोकतंत्र है या जो उसकी प्रशासनिक प्रणाली है उसके ऊपर हम हाथ डालने की कोशिश नहीं करेंगे, और चीन में जो भी हमारी व्यवस्था है उस व्यवस्था को हम हांगकांग में लागू नहीं करेंगे। अब दूसरा काम उन्होंने ये किया कि एक नया सिक्योरिटी लॉ हांगकांग में लेके आए, जिसके कारण कि जो भी अगर कोई आज़ादी की बात करता है या अपनी आवाज़ उठाता है या चीन की सरकार के खिलाफ बोलता है या और कोई इस तरह का काम करता है तो उसे बहुत ही कड़ा और कठोर दंड दिया जाएगा। और तीसरा काम उन्होंने ये किया कि जो उनकी सरहद भारत के साथ लगती है उसके ऊपर तनाव पैदा किया, वहां पे उस सरहद में अंदर आके जो भारत की सीमा है उसमें घुसकर तनाव पैदा किया। अब इसका अगर आप ये तीनों चीजों को एक परिपेक्ष में देखें, इसका सीधा सीधा मकसद ये था कि ये जो COVID-19 का लांछन लग रहा था चीन के ऊपर, इस COVID-19 की हेडलाइंस को दुनिया से आके अखबारों से हटाने के लिए, तो एक आपके मैरिटाइम क्राइसिस साउथ चाइना सी, एक आपके सॉवरेनिटी क्राइसिस हांगकांग, और एक टेरिटोरियल क्राइसिस। और वो टेरिटोरियल क्राइसिस कहाँ पे, जहां पे तीन परमाणु मुल्कों की सरहद मिलती। तो अगर जहां पे तीन परमाणु मुल्कों की सरहद मिलती हो वहां पे आप मिलिट्री एक्टिविटी शुरू करें तो दुनिया में तो छपेगा, क्योंकि कोविड से तो लोग धीरे धीरे मर रहे हैं, अगर खुदा ना खास्ता कोई परमाणु परिस्थिति आ जाती है तो पूरी दुनिया ही तबाह हो जाएगी। तो बहुत एक सोची समझी संयोजित रणनीति के तहत चीन ने ये किया। और इसका कारण ये है कि जब से शी जिनपिंग चीन के महासचिव बने हैं कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी के और चीन के राष्ट्रपति बने हैं, उन्होंने एक बहुत संयोजित ढंग से चीन का जो इन्फ्लुएंस है उसको पूरी दुनिया में फैलाने की कोशिश की, चाहे वो बेल्ट एंड रोड इनिशिएटिव के माध्यम से हो, चाहे जो विकासशील देश हैं, गरीब देश हैं, उनको कर्ज देने के मार्फत हो, या और ऐसी नीतियां अपनाई गई अफ्रीका में कि जहाँ पे जो नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज हैं उन लोगों के, कुदरती पदार्थ हैं, उनके ऊपर कब्जा किया जाए। तो एक बहुत ही संयोजित तरीके से उन्होंने चीन के इन्फ्लुएंस का विस्तार करना शुरू किया। और वो इसलिए शुरू किया कि दुनिया में सोवियत यूनियन के कोलैप्स के बाद जो अकेली महाशक्ति बची थी अमेरिका, वो अफगानिस्तान और इराक की लड़ाई के बाद एक तो एग्जॉस्ट हो गई, दूसरा बहुत उनकी पूंजी खर्च हो गई, बहुत उनके लोग मारे गए, और अमेरिका के अंदर से आवाज उठनी शुरू हुई कि भाई हमको पूरी दुनिया का थानेदार बनने की क्या जरूरत है, हमको अपने यहाँ पे जो मूलभूत ढांचा है उसको सुधारने की जरूरत है। अगर आप कभी न्यूयॉर्क एयरपोर्ट पे गए हो तो न्यूयॉर्क एयरपोर्ट वैसा ही लगता है जैसे दिल्ली का पुराना एयरपोर्ट हुआ करता था। आई मीन द कंडीशन इज एज डिलैपिडेटेड एज दैट। सो बिकॉज अमेरिका में जो ग्रेट डिप्रेशन आया था जिनका अजीत कुमार झा जी ने जिक्र किया, उसके बाद जो न्यू डील रूजवेल्ट ने अनाउंस की थी, उसके बाद कभी अर्बन रिन्यूअल हो ही नहीं पाया, अमेरिका अपने इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर के ऊपर इन्वेस्ट कर ही नहीं पाया। और जो इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर है अमेरिका में, चाहे वो टेलीकॉम इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर हो, चाहे रोड इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर हो, चाहे बाकी जो जो बुनियादी ढांचा है, वो सब लेगेसी इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर हो गया है, और बहुत सारे दुनिया के मुल्क आगे निकल गए हैं। तो ये संदर्भ और इस परिपेक्ष में जो चीन भारत की सीमा के ऊपर कर रहा है उसको देखने की जरूरत है। पर जिस तरह से भारत की सरकार ने इन तीनों क्राइसिस से निपटने की कोशिश की, चाहे कोविड 19 हो, चाहे उसके कारण जो अर्थव्यवस्था तबाह हुई हो, या जो चीन का आक्रमण है, वो साफ तौर पे ये बताता है कि इस देश में बहुत बड़ा गवर्नेंस डेफिसिट है। प्रधानमंत्री का ये कहना ऑल पार्टी मीटिंग में 19 जून को कि ना कोई हमारी सरहद में घुसा है और ना ही कभी घुसा था, ना ही कोई अभी घुसा हुआ है, तो यही तो चीन कह रहा था। तो जो हमारे सैनिक मारे गए गलवान वैली में, तो क्या वो चीन की सरजमीन पे मारे गए थे? क्या भारत के चीन की सरजमीन में घुसा हुआ है? अब ये एक लंबा विषय है कि वो जो बॉर्डर है चाइना के साथ, वो 1865 के बाद कभी डिमार्केट ही नहीं हुआ। जो अंग्रेज थे उन्होंने दो बारी कोशिश की, जिसको फॉरेन ऑफिस लाइन कहते हैं या आर्डेग लाइन कहते हैं, उसके बाद मैकडोनल्ड लाइन, उसके बाद मैकमोहन लाइन, जो वेस्टर्न सेक्टर है और ईस्टर्न सेक्टर है, उन्होंने कोशिश की कि किसी तरह से चीन के साथ जो ब्रिटेन की बाउंड्रीज थी, जिसके ब्रिटेन ने भारत पे कब्जा किया हुआ था, वो डिफाइन हो जाए, पर चीन ने उसको एक्सेप्ट नहीं किया। और जब चीन में कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी का राज काबिज हुआ 1949 में, तो उन्होंने ये जो पूरा पीरियड था 1839 से 1949 तक, उसको एक सेंचुरी ऑफ ह्यूमिलिएशन डब करते हुए उस दौरान जितने करार चीन ने किए थे, उन सारे करारों को उन्होंने निरस्त कर दिया, रद्द कर दिया। तो अब हुआ ये है कि जब से माओ सुई तुंग की मौत हुई 1976 में और डेंग शाओपिंग आए और चीन ने आर्थिक तरक्की करनी शुरू कर की, तो चीन भारत से बहुत आगे निकल गया। आज चीन की अर्थव्यवस्था भारत के 4 गुना अर्थव्यवस्था से ज्यादा है। आज चीन दूसरा ऐसा मुल्क है दुनिया में जो अपने डिफेंस एक्सपेंडिचर के ऊपर खर्चा करता है, और कई और ऐसे पहलू हैं जिसमें चीन काफी आगे निकल गया। और इस परिपेक्ष में, इस संदर्भ में, जब चीन और अमेरिका की ट्रेड वॉर चल रही हो, भारत को भी बहुत ही सोच समझ के कि उसकी क्या रणनीति होनी चाहिए, कैसे स्टेटस को वो रिस्टोर करेंगे बॉर्डर के ऊपर, चीन के साथ आगे किस तरह के रिश्ते होने चाहिए, किस तरह से उसको नेविगेट करना है, क्या कोई प्रधानमंत्री जी ने ऐसा वायदा तो नहीं कर दिया था वुहान में और महाबलीपुरम में जब शी जिनपिंग मिले थे, जिसका खामियाजा हमको भुगतना पड़ रहा है। ये जो सारे तथ्य हैं, इनकी गुत्थी खुलेगी आने वाले समय। पर कुल मिलाकर एक बात बहुत स्पष्ट है कि इस देश में एक बहुत बड़ा गवर्नेंस डेफिसिट है, और जो सरकार की असलियत है वो लोगों के सामने आ गई है। दिक्कत ये है कि जो विपक्ष है, विपक्ष पूरी तरह से सुदृढ़ और पूरी तरह से ऑर्गेनाइज्ड नहीं दिखाई देता। लोगों को एनडीए भाजपा सरकार का इस समय कोई विकल्प नहीं दिखता है, और इसलिए भारत के जो प्रगतिशील शक्तियां हैं, जो राष्ट्रवादी शक्तियां हैं, जो धर्मनिरपेक्ष शक्तियां हैं, उनके ऊपर एक बहुत जिम्मेवारी है, क्योंकि इस देश में एक बहुत बड़ा समुदाय ऐसा है जिसने अपने आप को सेकेंड क्लास सिटीजन समझना शुरू कर दिया है, और ये भारत की एकता और अखंडता के लिए अच्छा नहीं है। जिस देश की इमोशनल यूनिटी टूट जाए, वो मुल्क अंदर से खोखला हो जाता है। तो इसलिए जो आने वाले 4-5 साल हैं, वो बहुत चुनौती भरे हैं, और बहुत ही सोच समझ के, बहुत ही विवेक से सरकार को काम करना चाहिए, जो मेरी उम्मीद है कि ये सरकार नहीं करेगी, क्योंकि इसके लिए एक मल्टी पार्टीजन कंसेंसस, एक आम सहमति कुछ मुद्दों के ऊपर तय करने की जरूरत है, जो श्री नरेंद्र मोदी के गवर्नेंस स्टाइल में है नहीं, बिकॉज ही इज एसेंशियली अ लोनर, इट इज माय वे और द हाईवे। तो दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण बात है कि उन्होंने भारत के को ऐसे हाईवे पर डाल दिया है जिस हाईवे के ऊपर एक्सीडेंट के बाद एक्सीडेंट ही होता जा रहा है। मैं इस देश के लिए ईश्वर से प्रार्थना करता हूं और एक बार फिर से राजेश सिंह जी का और सारे प्रबंधकों का बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करना चाहता हूं कि मुझे आज अपनी बात रखने का आपने मौका दिया। और मैं झा जी से और नीरज कुमार जी से माफी मांगता हूं क्योंकि मेरी 1 बजे स्टैंडिंग कमेटी है फाइनेंस की, तो मुझसे मुझे आपसे आज्ञा लेनी पड़ेगी। धन्यवाद।
I really liked the way that Manish Tiwari spoke, as I was pointing out, the fact that he cornered China, number one. Number two, that he pointed out there was a governance deficit in the way that the Modi government handled the crisis. In fact, he was very candid about it, that there was a failure at the point when the government completely ignored the crisis. In fact, he pointed out that Venkaiah Naidu in parliament had even told people, sort of, why are you wearing the mask in the early phase, pre-lockdown phase, and then the surprise element of the lockdown and the way it was handled. He kind of was critical about it. And finally, he also admitted that the opposition was not well organized, number one, and that... what we need now is something very, the crisis is getting worse in India, and that we must try and not commit the errors, as he pointed out. In fact, he pointed out that the way the Indian government is handling it is like a highway where you are entering into one accident over another. He even pointed out the Prime Minister is essentially a loner, and that is not the way to handle the crisis. Anyway, so the only thing I wish he was around and I could have asked him, that this Congress crisis that is taking place, the leadership crisis in the Congress, is it adding to the further problems we are facing, or would this help in the future? But since Mr. Tiwari is gone, let me shift the debate back to Neeraj. Neeraj, I have known Neeraj since I think we were 16 years old, and Neeraj was with me in Science College, later in Patna College, and then in Jawaharlal Nehru University. We studied together. Neeraj was in economics, I was in political science. We are bosom pals. We call each other at least 4 times a sort of week. I send newspapers to Neeraj. Neeraj gives me tips on how to handle, this financial situation that all of us face today. Neeraj, I would also point out, he was an extraordinary student throughout his career, very serious in JNU in economics. He was one of the sort of brightest students. It was the same batch in which Abhijit Binayak Banerjee was also a student, the person who got the Nobel Prize this year. My point is the stature of the debate is quite high, both in the way that Mr. Manish Tiwari explained the political crisis, and one expects Neeraj to sort of come up with serious questions, as I asked in my opening remarks. Is the crisis going to get worse as what we are facing today? What about the serious implications in terms of the economic crisis? What exactly are we facing? I reeled out some numbers, and I would expect Neeraj to go behind those numbers and give us an in-depth sort of analysis. And is there any hope at the end of the tunnel? Are we going to even debate, or is it too early to debate the recovery? Or is there going to be a recovery within, let's say, the end of this year, by next year? So I'll leave it to Neeraj. Let him sort of spell out his picture in terms of the economic vision and the other aspects of the crisis, touching on the sort of India versus China role, the trade sort of
war going on in the world, the state of the global economy, and to some extent, if possible, how is the Modi government handling the crisis, especially its economic policies of late. So over to you, Neeraj.
Thank you, Ajit. Because of the audio issue, maybe I may miss some of the issues. But anyway, I'll try to cover most of the issues. To start with, I would like to pay my homage to late Nagendranath Singh, who was a freedom fighter, a member of the UP Vidhan Parishad, and a lawyer. And apart from that, he has contributed greatly for development of education institutions in Purvanchal region, which has contributed to development of that region. So my regards, my homage to the great soul. I would also like to thank Rajesh, our friend, and maybe what capacity he is holding in the trust, Nagendranath Singh Memorial Trust, for giving me the opportunity to interact with all of you. Before I start a discussion on what is the impact of this COVID crisis on the global economy and the Indian economy, I would first like to touch upon the state of the economy, the global economy, as well as the Indian economy, before the COVID crisis actually hit us. All of us are aware that the global economy was not in a great shape because of number of reasons. One of the reasons was growing protectionism in various countries. The other reason was there was a trade conflict between US and China, which Ajit and both Manish Tiwariji has mentioned. The third reason was the commodity prices were falling because of the oil producing countries. They had certain differences amongst them, and that is why the crude prices had already started falling. And there was uncertainty in the Eurozone because of Brexit. And what was the net result? The net result was that international trade was the international was growing at 8% in 2019 compared to 9% in 2018 and 18% in 2017. And the volume and the magnitude of international trade is very important for the growth and development of the global economy. When we look at the Indian economy, we have seen that in the last financial year, the economy was going down. And by the end of third quarter, if we look at the third quarter result of the financial year 2019-20, the growth rate had gone down below 5%. It was 4.7%. And when we look at the last quarter of the previous financial year, it tanked to 3.1%. So at that time, the pandemic had actually hit us. So in this kind of scenario, when the economy was not in a very great shape, when we look, either we look at the global economy or the Indian economy, the pandemic hit us. And what happened when the pandemic hit us? I would not talk about the number of people who were infected, the number of people who died, because both Ajit and Manish ji have discussed about it. The immediate response of the governments across the world was lockdown. Most of the countries, there was a lockdown. 80 countries across the world closed their borders and they did not allow foreigners to enter their country. There were a lot of travel restrictions. Ports were closed down. The airlines stopped there. In fact, practically the airline business was closed after the lockdown. And the net impact, what has been the impact of this lockdown? The first thing that happened, it created large scale unemployment. As per estimate, the unemployment rate across the globe went up to 10%. It has never happened. It matches the unemployment rate of Great Depression. And it was also seen that unemployment hit us in a very bad way. The unorganized sector or the informal sector, which Ajit was referring to, was the worst hit. The size of the unorganized sector across the world is, it contributes 33% of the global GDP, but it employs 70% of the workforce. So any hit to the unorganized sector would have a huge impact on unemployment. Another thing which was noticed, that most of the people who lost their jobs were either young people or people who were in blue-collar jobs. People in white-collar jobs or people working in the organized sector, they mostly shifted to working from home. They were able to work from home. So that was another thing. If I look at the Indian economy, all of us are aware that we had a huge migrant crisis. Lot of people, the population is around 13.9 crores. Almost 14 crore people move out to big cities in India to work. And most of these people are engaged in the unorganized sector. All the 14 crore people lost their jobs for some, and the miseries they had to face, I think all of you are aware of it. So I will not talk about it. I will not discuss it. The second impact, because of the travel restrictions, the global supply chain collapsed. And what was the impact of the global supply chain, collapsing of the global supply chain? International trade, it is believed in the current financial year, will on an average be, will degrow by 18.5%. It may vary from country to country. Country who are heavily into exports, their international trade volume is likely to go down by 33%, while in other countries, it may go down by 13%. So that was another major problem that happened. And there was a huge erosion of human capital. What do I mean by that? First, lot of people lost their jobs, which all of us are aware of. Today, the number is exceeding 8 lakh people have lost their jobs. I have already discussed about unemployment. Lot of people lost work. And the third, and which is very important, which does not appear to be great at this moment, but we must recognize that 150 crore children across the globe were deprived of education because of closure of schools. So that is another loss of. We have seen that stock market collapsed in the month of February itself, because it has always been said that the stock market actually foresees what is going to happen, and the result happens before the actually the problem hits us, and it happens in a good scenario also. You will see the peak before actually the peak is actually achieved. So the stock market collapsed in February itself. We know that some of the industries were very, very badly hit. As I mentioned earlier, because of travel restrictions and because of the lockdown, there were a lot of ports closed down, there was movement closed down, and there was already a problem in the area of fuel prices. The result was that the crude market was very, very badly hit. Prices fell down to $20 per barrel. This is unprecedented. The other industry which has been very badly hit is travel, naturally because of the lockdown. Associated with travel is tourism. Tourism is another industry which was very badly hit. And we all know that restaurants, hotels, etc. were badly hit. Because of travel restrictions, automobile industry was also badly hit, and many other industries. When I look at the worst hit countries, countries which are dependent on commodity exports, they were badly hit. The underdeveloped countries are also very badly hit because of three reasons. One is they have a very huge unorganized market. So a lot of people, a huge population is engaged in the unorganized sector. The second factor is because of the global lockdown, the remittances fell very steeply to the underdeveloped country. Third reason was the FDI investors. FDI was also pulled out in huge magnitude. If I look at Asia alone, $2 billion was pulled out. From India, $16 billion were pulled out, which in turn is likely to create huge inflationary pressures in the days to come. And the net result of all this is naturally the growth rate will tank. There were some estimates which were made in the month of March. As per this initial estimates by IMF, growth rate was expected to contract by 2.2% globally. But this was based on the assumption that once the lockdown is over, the economy will bounce back and things will start improving. But that did not happen. The situation worsened day by day. And in June, the World Bank estimated that the contraction of the economy in the year 2020 would be of the magnitude of 5.2%. And they said that Indian economy will contract by 3.7%. This again was based on the assumption that September onwards, things will start improving. But when we look at the present scenario and the results of the first quarter, that is June end quarter, in US, in India, in Europe, the situation is extremely gloomy. You will be surprised to know that at the end of June, on an annualized basis, US economy contracted by 33%. The contraction in Eurozone was of the magnitude of 28%. The CSO figures for India is not available at the moment, but as per estimate by State Bank of India, the contraction in the Indian economy at the end of first quarter is of the tune of 16.5%. And as per latest estimates, it is believed that the global economy will contract by 8.5% in the year 2020. It will contract by 8.5%, which means that, and it has, in fact, some estimates are even worse. The size of the global economy is $90 trillion. And as per some estimates, the contraction in the global economy will be of the tune of $12 trillion. So that will be the kind of hardship that we have to face. Now, if this is the situation, what would be the impact on people? It is estimated, but before I talk about the impact, I will just like to discuss that how big is this crisis? This crisis is much bigger than the 2008 crisis because of various reasons. One reason is it is widespread. It has hit all sectors and it has disrupted the supply chain, which did not happen in 2008. And it has hit the unorganized sector in a very, very bad way. The crisis is as big as the Great Depression, where the global economy contracted by 8.5%. People say, some economists say, that it may even exceed the magnitude of the Great Depression. And what is the impact of all this contraction? It is estimated that by the end of this financial year, that is 2020, the global per capita income will go down by 9.5%. And as per estimate of SBI and World Bank, the Indian per capita income is likely to go down by 5.4%, which means growing impoverishment. And if the supply chain continues to be like this, then in the remote corners, it will not be possible to provide food. And there may be a lot of starvation deaths also. So that is the scenario which is visible at the moment. Now, when lockdown happened and people saw misery all across, there was a huge debate on whether there is a trade-off between life and livelihood. It was believed that, of course, saving lives is important, but at the same time, it is also important to save the jobs of people. If the economy does not pick up, people may start dying of starvation. And because of that, globally, some partial relaxation opening of the economy started happening. And governments across the world decided to introduce huge stimulus packages through monetary and fiscal policies. The size of the package, which if I talk about the global economy, is as big as $10 trillion. US injected $2 trillion. India has also announced injection of 20 lakh crore rupees as a stimulus. And what is the objective of this stimulus? The objective is to strengthen the public health infrastructures to start with. Also to ensure that the most vulnerable section of the population is supported. The weak companies and the MSMEs are supported. And also to ensure that we create a roadmap for future growth. And the various fiscal and monetary measures were taken. On the fiscal front, what are the various measures which were taken? And I think many of you are aware of it, but I will just like to discuss. Governments across the world announced tax cuts, tax deferrals, or benefit transfers, direct benefit transfers. It was done in India also. It has been done in the form of direct cash transfers to Jan Dhan accounts. It has also been done by direct food distribution through the PDS. Now, we all know that our PDS system today is definitely much better than what it used to be in the past. But at the same time, it does not cover the entire people who actually need support. So even today, a lot of people, even though they need support of these government programs, they continue to suffer. However, certain initiatives were taken. But the cost of these initiatives by the government is very, very huge. From where to organize funds, so that the government can make these expenses. Governments across the world resorted to huge public borrowing. Normally, there is a borrowing cap which every and certain discipline which every government adheres to. It is believed that the size of the borrowing should not be more than 4% of the GDP of that particular country. But it is estimated that in this particular year, the size of the borrowing will be much bigger and it will be close to 11% of the global GDP. And in some countries, it can be even bigger. There are certain global discipline related to deficit financing also. In case of developed countries, they tried to keep their deficits within 3.3%. But as per the latest estimates, it is believed that deficit financing in developed country will go up to 16.6%. And in developing countries, it can be of the tune of almost 11%. In India also, the size of the deficit is believed to be, which we are going to see at the end of the year, would be of the magnitude of almost 15%. So all these things are, we will agree that some unprecedented steps have been. On the monetary fund also, a lot of measures were taken across the world and also in India. And what are the various things which have been done? Definitely the conventional measures like rate cut, like reduction in cash reserve ratio. And apart from that, on the monetary fund, governments across the world have used some very modern monetary tools like foreign exchange swaps, asset purchase, and in India, lot of new monetary institutions have, fintech companies have come up. Attempt has been made to provide credit support to companies, particularly to MSMEs. And globally, it is estimated that central banks across the world have provided for an injection of $17 trillion in the current year. So a lot of steps are being taken across the world. But the big question is it enough? But before that, I would like to just mention what we have seen. Definitely, some improvement is visible in terms of agriculture has started picking up in our country. Food procurement was record high. Tractor sales improved. Apart from that, bank credit has gone up. Bank deposits have gone up. We have seen growth in the insurance industry. We have seen growth in fuel consumption, electricity consumption. Some green shoots are there. But even though it is, we have not achieved normalcy, as a result, the estimated growth rate is falling day by day. Now, measures are taken, some improvements are visible. But is it enough? Is it enough? Or we need to do much more? The answer is, it is not enough. And will all these measures solve the problem? Why? There are various reasons. The first thing, there is complete uncertainty about the pandemic. We do not know when the pandemic will go. As per a study conducted by the Gates Foundation, they believe, though some vaccines have been introduced in Russia without the proper testing and all, but as per Gates Foundation, mass production of an effective vaccine will be possible only by the end of the year 2021. And only when mass production happens, it will be possible to immunize the world population, and then only the pandemic can be controlled. And this is also an estimate. So there is complete uncertainty about when this thing is going to end. The other factor is that other economic factors which are there is, we have seen the organized sector shifting from the culture of work from home. Now, what would be the impact? It will have a terrible impact on the demand for commercial spaces. Lot of, particularly the tech companies have already announced that they will now prefer to operate a number of their operations from the homes of the employees, and they may surrender some of the commercial space. And if this happens, the real estate sector is going to face a serious problem. We have also seen that online business has picked up to a great extent. There are many first-time users of online business, and many of them find it very convenient. And if actually what Gates Foundation says is correct, and we are talking about social distancing, then people will continue to resort to online sale and purchase. And if this happens, the retail sector is going to suffer very, very badly. And in India, the size of the retail sector is very, very huge. So that means huge unemployment will be created in the retail sector. How the economy will handle that is not clear. Apart from that, we also have seen that when we look at the organized sector, organized business and organized sectors, all of them have taken a hit, and the CFOs and the CEOs of these companies, they realize that the revenue will fall. The revenue will dip by almost 25%. That is their estimate. But they want to protect their profits. And how can they protect their profits if their revenue is falling? They would like to reduce cost. They would like to cut cost. And the best way of cutting cost is laying off of employees. Then it means unemployment will also arise in the organized sector. Today it is not visible, but in the coming days you will see unemployment in the organized sector also. So that is another problem that we are able to see. And if the per capita income is going down, unemployment is going to increase, definitely social tensions will be created, and the world will have to face the challenge which may appear on the social front also. The demand for labor is also increasing very fast. The nature of demand, the demand for skilled labor is increasing, and unskilled labor demand is going down. When we look at the underdeveloped countries, the availability of skilled labor is limited, and they are likely to face serious problem in the days to come. So the situation is absolutely unclear. And there is another fear, I think, another problem which is visible. I don't say it is a fear, which is visible. Today, those who believe in free trade, free economy, market stabilizers, even they have started losing confidence in the concept of laissez-faire. People now understand that there is a need of government intervention, that there is a need of government control, and the nature of the economy in various ways is going to change across the world. And in that scenario, is it enough? The measures that have been taken, are the measures enough? Now, this pandemic has taught us a lot of lessons. And what are these lessons? These are also very important, and which is important in view of the fact that in future also we may have such pandemics, because we all know that urbanization is growing, globalization is there, urbanization is going, that means the concentration of population in limited spaces will be high, and in that scenario the risk of new epidemics may be there. So there is a need to develop the public health infrastructure across the world. The investment in the public health infrastructure today is very, very limited. If I look at India, India invests only 1.15% of its annual budget in the area of public health. Now that has to go up. That is an important lesson that we have to learn. The other thing is, there is a need for global cooperation. Global cooperation has to grow up. In a scenario when you have a pandemic and there is a serious threat, without global cooperation, it is very difficult to tide over such challenges. If you agree with the study of the Gates Foundation that we may not have a vaccine by end of 2021, which can be produced on a mass scale, and the vaccine which is likely to come out, it is expected to be very, very expensive. If it is expensive, many poor countries will not be able to provide or purchase this vaccine for their entire population. And in that situation, the rich countries have to support them. If they do not support them, there will be reservoirs of this virus in different pockets. And if this reservoir continues, the disease will pop up again and again here and there. So if they support, it is not just out of altruism. It is also a need for them. So there is a need of global cooperation which should increase. Even in our country, there is a need to increase the cooperation between center state. Wherever there is a federal structure, there is a need to raise the level of cooperation between centers and the states. We also need to raise the level of awareness in the area of healthcare and hygiene. That will help us to handle future such pandemics. We need a very dynamic management of companies. In fact, companies who can immediately change the nature of their working, who can shift their workers from one place to another. A dynamic management structure is required to face such challenges. And lot needs to be invested in the area of innovation in healthcare. Lot of investment is required in R&D in the area of healthcare. That is another thing which is very important. Now, looking at the entire state of affairs, it is very difficult to say when the pandemic will end, or when the problem will be solved, or whether the shape of economic improvement or upliftment, whether it will be V-shaped or L-shaped or W-shaped, it is very difficult to say. If you ask me, I believe it cannot be better than L-shaped. That is the best estimate which I can make. The countries who are open to change, who are open to bring about reforms in view of the economic challenges, they will be better placed to handle this crisis. Countries with deep pockets who can sustain the crisis for a longer period of time would be in a better position to handle the crisis. If all the institution companies collapse and any economy has to start from zero, the problem will take a very long time to get solved. And in this situation, countries with deep pockets are in a much better position. And that means that the developing economies have a serious job at hand. The other thing, in fact, which is also very important, is countries who try to develop their tech sector, who try to develop their education, they will be in a better position to handle this crisis as well as all such future crises. And when I look at India, I see there is a huge opportunity, because India has a very efficient and growing tech sector, and the availability of skilled manpower in the tech sector is very huge. So some silver lining is there for our country. But at the end, I would not be in a position to say for sure that the problem will end very soon. The situation appears to be difficult, and we have to ensure, contribute by way of social distancing or whatever the government suggests, to ensure that at least at the local level, wherever we operate, we are able to help the governments in tiding over the crisis. So the situation is difficult. With this, I would close and thank once again Rajesh and his trust for giving me the opportunity to talk. Can't hear. I can't hear you.
Aha, that's right. Now you can hear me because I was muted.
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. Thanks, Neeraj. What I would call an exceptionally good presentation. In depth, you know, if I want to summarize you, it is going to take me a long time. What I liked about the way you presented, that you began with the focus on jobs. You began by pointing out that how this entire crisis, the fact that 80 countries were locked down, an unprecedented situation, you know, they closed their borders, and what that led to was a total destruction of the informal sector in developing countries, large-scale unemployment. You pointed out that the blue-collar jobs were the worst affected. And in India, of course, we saw this massive migrant crisis, almost like 14 crore people, you know, in a way one can say, lost their jobs. In addition to what you suggested, that even in the white collar, people are likely to lose jobs that there was a total failure of the global supply chain, erosion of the human capital. So all in all, it was an excellent presentation. You know, you even talked about the stock market collapse in February. I guess one question that arises in mind, I'll have about three or four questions. One is that suddenly some people, they do not understand that when the Indian economy is sinking, why has the stock market started picking up? I mean, one obvious reason is that governments are pushing so much. They are just chapoing notes, right? They are just pushing so much money into the world economy to increase liquidity. So that might be one possible reason. But anyway, I would like you to answer that question for our audience, if possible. The other point that you made, very interesting, you pointed out that the commodity prices were falling pre-COVID, which became worse. The commodity export has been very badly hit. That the developing countries are the ones which have been hit the worst. And in the future also, in fact, you argued that why we need global cooperation is because the rich countries, which have deep pockets, should be able to share should share the problems of the poor countries. In fact, it's a typical problem. Even within the rich countries, it's the poor people that have been affected the worst. I mean, in the US, we know that the blacks, the Latinos, the colored people, the non-whites have been hit the worst. And the other part of the crisis, which you kind of hinted at, is this urban cities, that the urban cities have been hit very badly. We saw the collapse of New York, several other cities in the US, including California recently. We saw the same thing happening in Italy and Spain, England and France, and you know, all over. In India, we saw the worst hit cities were Bombay and Delhi, Chennai, Calcutta now, to a great extent, now even the first class cities. So this whole business about urban crowding, we need to sort of prevent. So all in all, I think it was an excellent presentation. Let me ask you, as I pointed out, one was this question about how the stock market has started sort of picking up. Why? Then the second question that I wanted to ask you, I was always taught that capitalism is philosophically what holds capitalism together is the system of contract, the contract between employer and employed, in the contract, if you will, in marriage between, you know, husband and wife. I mean, in a marriage, you're supposed to take care of your family, a contract of all sorts, right? It's the failure of contract that leads to legal problems. Now, what I feel that other than what you explained with in great details, what has happened in this particular crisis that we saw, and we can blame governments, but especially the private sector, they failed largely in sort of what I would say holding the contract. After all, many capitalists in this country and elsewhere in the US and other parts of the world, they have made millions and trillions in profit in the past. But in 5 months, when the world economy collapsed, they just threw people out of jobs. I mean, all these jobs, if someone would argue, where would they get their money? The argument would be, after all, they had enormous reserves. I mean, they had made huge amount of profits. So the way they have been throwing people out of jobs simply because of a collapse of the global economy in the last 5 months shows that people have not really held the issue of contract seriously. So that is something I certainly want you to comment on. And finally, India. I mean, obviously, the dream of the 5 trillion economy seems to be over. And as some people are arguing, you may not reach the 5 trillion economy even by 2030. The question is there any hope? I mean, you talked about some green shoots in certain sectors, particularly agriculture and few others, but the dimensions of the problem seems to show a kind of very negative future, especially for a country like India, which is, you know, to be honest, might be prosperity in pockets, but largely very poor. So is there any hope? Can the Modi government, can you suggest that the Modi government try out a formula which might be able to help in handling this crisis better in the future? These are the three questions.
So over to you, Neeraj. Thanks, Ajit, for your comments. And I would like to handle these questions to the best of my ability. The first thing regarding stock market. The stock market actually is not a true picture of the economy. It doesn't mirror the economy. That is the scenario. As per some study, it is said that it actually foresees what is going to happen. It is dependent on base, it reacts. It actually precedes any either slump or boom, actually precedes what actually happens. We have seen that. The lockdown was announced in the month of March, but the stock market in India tanked in the month of February. It happened actually before the lockdown was announced. It has started going up at the time when lockdown actually happened. So it is more dependent on hope. It basically foresees what is going to happen. And similarly, because of the stimulus package, the hope was, or it foresaw, that the economy will pick up. And that is why this improvement will, this whatever we see has happened. But there are some other factors also which I would like to discuss. The stock market in India actually many a times follows the international stock market also, the Dow Jones and other Chinese market or different markets. Now let us look at what has happened in US, in Dow Jones. Dow Jones actually also tanked in the month of February. It went down to 23,500 points. And the normal used to be 29,000 points. Now today it is around 27,000 points. It has picked up by almost 30%. So that is what has happened in India is also maybe to some extent a reflection. And why did it pick up in US? It picked up in US. One is, of course, the 2 trillion injection. The other factor why it picked up in US was because the tech sector in US is just booming. The stock prices of companies like Amazon, Apple, Facebook, Zoom, and etc., they have grown by almost 60%. The stock price of Amazon in February was 2,000. Today, it is around 3,500. So that is the kind of growth. And the size of the tech sector in US is very high. So that is one reason why it has grown in US. In India also, the tech sector has seen growth. So that is one factor. And in fact, yesterday only I was talking to some of my colleagues. One of the factors which people have started talking about earlier, where did people put in their money? People used to, majority of the people who are not very market savvy, they used to put their savings in either fixed deposits or post office deposits. Now the rate of interest in banks have also, because of the central bank measures announced by central bank, they have also gone down very, very significantly. And that is reflected also in the post office deposits. The real estate where people used to invest today is in a very bad shape. So people are also not prepared to invest in real estate. So there are only two sectors where people are seeing some growth. One is the price of gold and the other is stock market. So that is also another factor why we see some buoyancy in the stock market. However, as per the latest study by, in fact, the governor of the Reserve Bank announced, had a web conference, webinars few days back with the banks. And in that webinar, he discussed that in the coming, this is not going to stay for long. And he believes that it is going to come down once again, not very steeply, but it is going to come down in the coming future. So this is regarding the stock market. That is one. The second question was regarding employer-employee relationship in a capitalistic structure, which you were talking about. Of course, what is visible today is unfortunate, but there are various reasons for that. One reason is, if you look at the top industrialists of today or the capitalists of today, there are a lot of new people who are there. The traditional capitalists, the rich people, they have either become smaller today or they are not there. Their profitability today, there are many people who are facing bankruptcies and all. So they are also not in a very good shape. Lot of companies today in India are facing bankruptcy, and it is predicted that if this COVID crisis continues in India and in many developing countries, lot of companies will become insolvent and they will have to go for bankruptcy. So their financial health today is not very sound. And there is another factor also which is important, is the employer-employee relationship is also changing. In the past, we have seen generations joining in a company and retiring from that company. That kind of relationship between the employer-employee does not exist today. Because on the employee side also, people are jumping from one job to another, changing jobs. The concept of loyalty to a particular company, that is also not there from the side of the employees. As a result, it is a problem, according to me, which is double-sided, both from the side of the capitalist as well as from the side of the employees. The kind of relationship does not exist today. That, according to me, is the reason why. Because the moment industrialist or a company owner or a capitalist sees that the profits are dwindling, they start cutting their cost. And once, the best way to cut cost in the short run is laying off employees. So that is what we are seeing today. And I missed your third question. What was the third question?
Third question was, is there some way that the Modi government can come up with a sort of better alternative set of policies which might help to, you know, fight this crisis compared to what it has done until now? Is there a sort of, like, for example, take the case of China. And I mean, China, the crisis started in China, and China has been able to get out of the crisis. In fact, the recent figures is it has posted some amount of growth, positive growth in the last quarter. Now, obviously, it's our enemy. I'm not arguing for aping the Chinese model, but can we come up with our own kind of, Mr. Modi talked about this entire sort of Swadeshi and self-help, et cetera, et cetera. But is there some other economic, what is a good, sound economic sort of model that one can follow to at the end come up with some kind of solution to this crisis?
So it's a very difficult question. And I think all of us are aware of the conventional tools which has been used across the world. But in case of the conventional tools, there is a particular gestation period. They take certain time. They do not give immediate results. And in view of the downturn which is visible today, the time that will may be taken is much longer. But one thing we forget about China. The China, apart from for using the various traditional tools, they also did something. This something very, I would say, good has happened in China. Lot of innovations have also happened in China. Today, if you look at the applications, in fact, there was a question to the CEO of Apple that why do you want to stay in China? He said that the kind of innovation in the area of developing applications that is visible in China that makes our business profitable, that is not happening in another country. And that is why I'm not too sure whether shifting to India will be a great idea. So our country also needs innovation, innovation in every field, not only in the tech sector, in other fields also. I think that is one very important factor, which is there. And unfortunately, you will recall that last year, Wozniak had come to India, and Wozniak had commented that India's tech sector is very strong and Indian people are very, very skilled as far as technology is concerned, as far as software is concerned. But there is one problem. There is a need to develop the entrepreneurial outlook, the aptitude. The people are comfortable taking jobs instead of trying to become an entrepreneur. In the recent days, we have seen some youngsters, pass outs of IITs, etc., starting some new business, getting into startups. And the one thing which the government needs to do is the government support which is provided to the startups is not adequate. I have discussed with many of them and they complain about the opaque tax policies, the opaque policies regarding providing support or audit and various things, which is very bureaucratic in nature. And that is why many youngsters are hesitating to get into something new, or they are hesitating, or many people who have started something have gone back and have taken up some job here and there. So the government really needs to encourage and support youngsters, the trained people, to get into something new. They need to encourage young entrepreneurs so that they can work on developing something new. And only then we can see innovation in this country. And if we want to see geometric progression in our country in terms of GDP growth, etc., I think new people, youngsters, new entrepreneurs have to be encouraged. That is another step which needs to be taken, and we are wanting in that particular area. That is something which I feel.
Thank you, Neeraj. Thank you for an exceptionally good and in-depth sort of analysis of the global economy, of the Indian economy, the future scenario. And you picked up each sector and you thrashed out, in sort of considerable detail and depth, what we are faced with and how to tackle them. In fact, at the end, you even talked about how the key are innovation, new entrepreneurs. And, of course, most of us know the conventional solution, which is pumping money into the infrastructure, the health sector, which you talked about in the beginning of your lecture, education, etc. Thank you very much. Thank you to the organizers, especially to our friend Rajesh Singh, who sort of organized the entire thing, although he's not visible. But without him, this great webinar would not have been possible. Thank you to his nephew who introduced us. And I will thank the technical team which organized it, despite pointing out that some of the big sort of faults in this entire webinar came out because of technicality. So we need, as Neeraj pointed out, innovation in technology. So that is one thing that we should pick out of this. But thanks anyway, thanks to Manish Tiwari, who's not around anymore, who had to leave, who actually, I must again confess, gave a very candid and politically sound sort of a lecture in which he pasted the Modi government. He pointed out, you know, the kind of mistakes they made pre-lockdown, and also later, as he concluded by saying, it's a highway where the Modi government is committing one error after another. He also softly sort of castigated the opposition by pointing out how in this country they are not organized. And, you know, there is, as he pointed out, there is no alternative to the NDA. So that is something that the opposition, especially his own party, the Congress party, which is at this moment squandering its every opportunity because of infighting within the Congress, they should think about and come up with a solution very soon. Soon we have a Bihar election coming up in less than, you know, about three months. We have 5 elections coming up next year in the month of May in states like West Bengal, Tamil Nadu, Assam, etc. So the opposition needs to come up quickly, you know, organize itself, get into the serious act before it squanders every opportunity. Thank you, everyone. And let me conclude by patting ourselves in the back and saying what I would call, under the circumstances, an extraordinary webinar. Thank you very much. Thank you.